Hello everyone, myself Dr. Shivangi Surti from the Department of Computer Engineering in LDRP Institute of Technology and Research. In this presentation, I am going to discuss about phases of compiler design part 3. In my previous two videos of part 1 and part 2, I discussed about the six phases of compiler, where the lexical analyzer phase takes source program as inputs. It generates a sequence of tokens, which is then passed to syntax analyzer. The syntax analyzer phase generates a syntax tree or parse tree, and that is taken by input by semantic analyzer phase. It generates a syntax tree with meaning, and it is given to intermediate code generator. Intermediate code generator generates the intermediate representation of source program, which is then optimized by code optimization phase. This optimized intermediate code is given to code generation to generate the target program, which is dependent on the machine. Now, apart from these six phases, two more activities are involved in the design of compiler. These activities are also called phases of compiler. One activity is symbol table management, and this is involved with all the six phases of compiler. That is, all the six phases will deal with symbol table management. Another activity is error handler, and that is also related with all the phases of compiler. So let us see these two activities in detail. Symbol table management, it interacts with all the phases and it is used as a reference table by all the phases. The purpose for symbol table management is compiler needs to record the identifiers or variables used in the source program. The identifier also includes function names. The rule is defined for identifier in the input domain of any programming language. These are like foreign words that need to be stored somewhere along with their attributes. Because when, for example, semantic analysis phase is checking for the scope of variable, it requires this information in advance. What is type of the variable? That is need to be checked by semantic phase. So the data type of any variable must be known by the semantic analysis phase. Then when code generation phase generates the relocatable address for any variable, where to store this address? Okay. So for this purpose, compiler needs to record the identifiers and to collect the information about various attributes of each identifier. The attributes for variable names are name of variable, type of variable, class of variable, size, relative offset within program, that is its relocatable machine address, then scope, what is the value of variable, and so on. The attributes for function names is name of function, how many arguments, that is number of arguments, which are the types of arguments, what is return type of the function, and method of passing each parameter, whether it is call by value, call by address, or call by reference. And hence for this purpose, symbol table is designed, that is a data structure containing a record for each identifier with the fields for the attributes. If we see, the lexical analyzer detects the identifier and it enters it in the symbol table, but it cannot determine all its attributes. The remaining phases enter information about the identifiers in the symbol table, and they may also use the entered information in different ways, as I said about semantic phase. So, semantic analyzer and intermediate code generation, they need to know the type of variable, then what is scope of variable, and other attributes. The code generation phase needs to enter and uses the details about storage assigned to an identifier. And hence, all these phases are interacting with the symbol table. Some phases they are entering the details or attributes about symbol table, about variables, and some phases perform the search in symbol table to use the information. So during compilation, as I said, all the phases often look up this table for definition of variables. For example, whether the variable used is defined before that or not. And hence, along with the symbol table creation, the management includes allocate the memory for new attribute or for new variable, free the memory of the variable that is out of scope, then search for specific variable or function name, insert new entry, set attribute, and get attribute. So the data structure that is used to implement the symbol table should be selected such that it minimizes the search time. We can use the hierarchical table instead of single flat table to reduce the search time. The other options to implement symbol table are linear list, search trees, or even hash tables can be used. Let us see one example of symbol table creation. Here in code, there is one global variable g and two functions in global scope, that is main and add. In main, two variables a and b are declared as local variables. Then in inner scope of main, that is one more block is defined in main, which includes the float variable f. Similarly, another inner scope or another inner block is defined in main that includes two integers I and j. The function add has two formal parameters a and b, and it declares one character as a local variable. Again in add function, variable k is declared in an inner block. So let us see the hierarchical symbol table creation for this. So first, the global symbol table is created that includes the information about all the global variables as well as functions declared in the global scope. So first variable is g, its type is a variable, its scope is global, and its data type is integer. Then main and add, two procedures are defined in global symbol table. Their scope is again global. The return type of main is void and the return type of add is integer. So this symbol table contains information about all the global variables and functions. Now if we see the function main and the function add, they are divided into, they are using different variables. So from this, at next level, we have a symbol table of main and we have a symbol table of add in hierarchical manner. The symbol table of main contains two local variables a and b. Their type is variable, their scope is inside procedure main, and their data type is integer. Apart from this, in main, two inner blocks are defined. They are at next scope. Their scope is not procedure main, but their scope is inner block, and hence in main, two more symbol tables in hierarchical structure. The first inner block f contains variable f having the data type float. Its scope is inner block and it is a variable. Two inner blocks are independent of each other. This inner block is an example like if we declare any variable inside a for loop, inside while loop, or even in if else. Then next inner block contains two variables I and j of type integer. So the symbol table of main again consists of three tables which defines the inner scopes. Similarly, in continuation with example, let us discuss the symbol table of add. Now here if we observe, add has two formal parameters a and b, and hence these parameters are also a part of add function, so they are considered inside the symbol table of add. These a and b are independent variables than a and b defined in main. Both of them are having different scopes. Both of them are entered in different symbol tables with different addresses. And hence, the change in one will not affect the other variable. So, two formal parameters or arguments A and B in scope procedure add, and one local variable C as a character again in the scope procedure add. Inside add function, again there is one inner scope declared with variable K. So one more symbol table at next level which consists of entry of K. So symbol K is an inner scope having data type integer. So this is the symbol table of add. The entire symbol table consists of global symbol table divided in two parts, main and add, and again main function is divided into further symbol tables. So if I combine these two slides, it will show you the entire symbol table structure for selected example. Another activity is error handler, that also deals with all the phases of compiler. The main role of error handler is error detection and reporting of errors. Each phase in analysis can identify the errors. For example, lexical phase is identifying invalid identifiers. Syntax phase is identifying any syntactical errors. Semantic phase is identifying any semantic errors. So after detection of errors, a phase should be able to deal with that error so that the compiler can proceed further. Okay? So that the compiler can also detect the errors in remaining part of the code. So suppose during lexical analysis phase, if it holds in an error state, it doesn't mean that the compilation should be halt over there. There should be some way that the compiler or lexical phase can recover from the error state and it can proceed the next statements. In syntax error, when the parser reaches in error state, first it will indicate the type of error and then some processing is required to be undone, which is already carried out by the parser. So to come out of the error states and to process the next statement is job of error recovery. So error handler consists of error detection as well as recovery from that error, and hence this is a vital role in overall operations of compiler. This reference book is Compilers, Principles, Techniques and Tools by Aho, Sethi and Ullman. Thank you.